script methods would matter. So I'm going to talk about obfuscation in this talk. You might have heard about this. It's a common topic, and basically it's the deliberate act of making source code that is difficult for humans to understand. JavaScript is usually done by using a modifier, and you will have a like this. Is, for example, the modified code or part of the modified code of the React. But in this case, I'm not talking about modification that is done automatically, but it's about obfuscation that's done by hand. So I'm going to have a couple of different examples how you can shift characters by hand to have source code that is somehow beautiful and for some unexpected designs. As in this example, you see so you can put this in the console, and once you run it, the generator is done in that shape. But maybe to make things clear, obfuscation has many aspects, and one aspect that I won't cover is security. So it can be used to bypass several security restrictions, but it's not the top. So we will focus on another aspect here, and this is the fun part. So I'm going to tell you how to use creative coding to do things that you might have not known about. So an example that I did some time ago was this piece of code. You see it's an HTML page with a opening and closing script tag, and inside there's some JavaScript. And you see there's also like comments, a circular comment in there. And once you run this, then you see that this will like animate the Earth in 3D in the software itself. So there are no external resources, it's all done in 1024 characters or bytes, and it's like one example. Another topic that I will cover here is code-bought. Code-boughting is kind of competition when you try to achieve a specific goal in a least amount of characters. Not sure if you've seen this contest by Evolution Gaming. And in the corner they announced the winners yesterday. And for today they have this exercise that you need to code dishes for very good balls and segment display. So you have this input and you see the top. And you have to write some code, and the code has to be as short as possible. You have a leaderboard, and the ones with the least amount of characters will win the contest.
Martin?
Can we
turn you louder?
Be louder?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. you will see the winners today, and I would really recommend to do this at your own and try to hang around with this case. I also prepared some other demos, and one thing that you might know is the JS1K contest. Not sure if you have ever
No.
Okay, but I've seen it, so it's a 10th time this year. It might be the last time, but you usually have a specific amount. You have a specific amount of characters, so you have 1,024 bytes in the end, which is like this, and then you can do whatever you like. This amount of camera. And one example that I want to show is from this year. It's from Yanni Kangas. It's a tunnel thing that runs for 2 minutes, and it's like having different light sources, and it's like a 3D effect with animations going on and like things that are thinking. And it's really cool. And the coolest thing is that, and I skip this because at the end, you will see there's a pong game in there too. He has some spare space left and had this little pong thing. Another one from this year is from Maxime Oxier. This is Super Mario Brothers, the first level, but only with blocks. So what you can, it's like really similar. You have enemies, you have things that you can put, you jump over different parts, and then at the end you have this pole where you run into it. And also in 1024 bytes, the Pac-Man game with the animated ghosting those are quite dumb, but it's okay. So if you see the source code, it's really tiny. So this is one type of competition of code blocks. So if you have a specific amount of space, but then you can do something. And if you think about the original Pac-Man game, you can also think about a different way to play code block in this sense. So one would be you have a defined amount of characters that you can authorize to frame filler, and the other would be to try to shrink this problem as much as possible. And I'm going to show you this statement on my outline for Pac-Man. So if you imagine Pac-Man is this yellow thing that's eating some dots, you could also think about this as, okay, we have an X ASCII character, but the dot is the thing that eats. And you can modify the game to make this look like this. So you have in the center the X are the ghosts, the O is the Pac-Man, and the dots is the what you have to eat, and the hashes are the walls, and you can play this game. And you can walk around, and the ghost tries to catch you, and you have to catch. The source code for this is only 348 bytes, and the full HTML. So you have the body unload tag, and the query tag, and everything is being rendered in this script tag. Another website I would really recommend that you should have a look is twitter.com. So like Twitter but with a D. And it's somehow similar to, it's a mix of Twitter and close to football, because you have an input field where you can type up to 140 characters and you see immediately the results. So it's a kind of live coding editor. And you can modify the code as you want, so you can change, it has this basic example with this pipe blocks and pipe blocks, and you can change it and make more blocks and change the speed or change the size and add some dependent things. And one thing that you might see, there are some shortcut functions like the capital S, the capital C, and the T, and these are shortcuts to sinus, cosinus, and current time. So it has some shortcuts that you don't have to waste characters, and then you can play on. And people do crazy things. So this is just a really simple example. One thing would be this. So this is a source code, and then in the end, it's a street going to the city. This one was another approach where we tried to create like a rainforms or ocean, but only like 66 bytes. So it's just one line of code to create this effect. Other people are doing crazy things like a raycaster that has some animations in the length of a tree or a park. So that's one line of practice. Or this Saturn thing that's been quite impressive. And what's really cool is that people start to fork other demos. And that's also a feature from the Twitter tool. So you can say fork this, and then you modify it, and then you publish a new version. And as you see in the beginning, I had this spinning world, and I wanted to create something that looks similar to the spinning world. And the first version I came up was with this sphere that is spinning, and it has some shapes that might look like continents, but it's not. But then after some time, somebody came up with a big bitmap encoder in 149. So here, I'm not sure if you can see this in the lower part, is that there are UTF 16 characters, and like every bit of this UTF 16 characters has this like information for one pixel. So you can encode 60 bits in a character, and you also have the rendering function that is like drawing a map of the world. And then the idea came up, can we somehow combine this approach with other approach that we see? So we know how to create spinning spheres, and to try to reduce them, and came up with a version that's only like 7 bytes. And after some forking and working together, tier one came up with a solution where you combined spinning thing with the encoding of the image. it looks like a dot. No, it's not perfect, but we continued with that. So we added some a kind of fake transparency, and in the end, someone was able, JChan, to make this like a colored version. It has some glitches, but you see there's a blue ocean and we land on that. And it's all done with this code. So 100, 400. So check this out, Twitter net. It's really impressive. So every week they so you can also like favorite things, and they have a high score for every week or every month. So. Okay. The next thing is reverse code call. So instead of trying to write in smart characters, there was a question, how many characters do we need to write any other time? And there were some experience with this before, and I did a rewrite and some research and created a website that's called JSON. And you see there's a parenthesis, the plus, the square, and no, the parenthesis, the plus, the square brackets, and the ampersand. And with this symbols, you can write every JavaScript code. You don't have to do this by hand. There's a website where you can enter your code, so for example, FrontCon, and it will output the JSON code, which in this case is about 1,200 characters. So there's no interpreter around this. You can just copy and paste this, and it will give you a code. So how does it work? I'm going to try to explain the basic concept. It's far more complicated, but just to give you the basic idea. So in JavaScript, we can do some conversions. So we can use the negation to create the false value. So we have a set of square brackets, which is not an empty array, which is false. And if we have the double negation, then we have true. So not false is true. And if we then add empty strings, or we could also say empty square brackets, then we can convert false and true, we can convert false and true. And then we can do things, grabbing symmetric characters on. So if we access the first character, we get T, second R, U, E, and so on. And if we then, for example, have, so it's zero base, so it's the second character of false, third character forwards, and so on, and we place this in a row, and we highlight those characters, and you see you can like add characters together to other words, for example, like and this is what we what I call Scrabble, so you can also get the word Scrabble for different objects and basic types in JavaScript. And this works with like similar words, but the most important part here was that it's possible to get the word constructor out of this. So constructor is from object, object undefined, false, true, 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 object, true, object, true. And this enables the most important thing here, because if you have an empty array and add constructor, constructor, then you can pass the word in any code if you like. And to explain this. So an empty array, the constructor for an empty array is a function. And from the function, the constructor is the function constructor. And function constructor is basically an eval that you can pass and put it. So you command these characters, have an eval, and then you can pass in any characters or sequence of characters that you like. Yeah, so check out JS Factor from. There's something going on because there's the pipeline operator proposal for years next. I'm sure you've heard about this. It might be possible to write JavaScript in 5 characters. This is like a visual development process. Yeah. Okay. Let's do some more interesting, visually interesting things here. One question that came up was, is it possible to write a symmetric JavaScript code? And it uses the same approach, and This is the output, or this is the input, actually the source code of another alert one example. So we have columns, and they are always mirrored. And in this case, it's like five columns, but if you correct the number to three columns, then you see it's always the same pattern. And what happens here is that the first row has a list of rods, the second row takes the character, and then the third row is just adding things together. So in this case, it will also be an alert. Yeah. Okay. Now to something that's different. No, I think not. That's also from this Barabbas. What is Barabbas? So Barabbas is the language or the writing system that it's used in Star Wars universe. So whenever you watch a Star Wars movie, everything that they write is in Barabbas. And it has some fancy looking characters. In the end, it's just a different alphabet that you can exchange for the Latin alphabet. And I took up the idea and created a website called Barabbas.js, and it gives you an input when you can enter special characters. For example, I've chosen this Latvian alphabet for the special characters from the Latvian alphabet, and it will output you some other code. And this is again an alert one. And the cool thing is that you can try this with different alphabet, and it gives you completely different aesthetics. So this is Greek. You can also import Icelandic roots. JavaScript that looks like from Game of Thrones, maybe. Can use Telugu. This is a language spoken in, by more than 80 million people in South India. This is interesting. This is German version. It's not only limited to characters, but you can send the words. So it's Yarnine, Yarnine, Schlüssel. It's also valid. Yeah. And this example is like in the end Barabbas, so it uses some German shapes that looks quite similar to what we have in the Star Wars alphabet, and it's by the JavaScript. And then you can play with like different shapes, only lines or slashes and so on, and it gives you completely different impressions. Okay, just a quick intro how this works. So the basic thing that we do here is similar to what we've seen in JSX. So we have, but we store some of the words into variables. So you would use Latin alphabet, we use A, B, C, D, and so on. And then we have these characters, and we shape this up a bit more. Then we see, okay, A is an empty string, B is not A, plus A is what's true, C is false, D is object, object, and so on. And if we combine this with other characters, then we get a constructor, and then we can pass our one, and at the end we have some nice looking code. In this example, it's Hebrew, which you have to read from right to left and set from right to left. So this works too. Yeah. And if we continue with this, then we could do something more complicated. So the examples you've seen is only in alert one, and the question was, is it possible to do more sophisticated demos? And one thing that I did is creating the matrix intro sequence with only Asian characters. So you see in the top, you're going to start this, there's a script tag, starting a script tag ending. And in the middle is all the code that you need to create this animation in canvas. Yeah, and the source code could be laid out differently. So usually, in some quite interested, it might go up to down. So I use spaces and tabs to align them. But in the end, it's like line by line. So this is the source code that will create the matrix. You can put this up here. It's the character for rain, but the generic two matrix, so don't worry. So these were characters that are visible. Now the question was, okay, are there invisible characters? And if you know different alphabets, then you might have heard that the Hangul alphabet, which is used in Korean, has some special, or in the Unicode system, has some special combining characters and filler characters. And there's one, or there are actually like four different fillers, and one of them is it's called zero width filler. So it's a character that's not visible and doesn't take up any space, which is cool. Because instead of ABC, you can use this invisible character and have code that is invisible. So this was their ES5 version, and it's also possible to write this with ES6. So this is an error one without any characters in there. It's working in all the browsers. So actually, some browsers will show you when you put this into a console, will give you a hint that there's something invisible. So browsers know how to bypass some security issues. So they work on things to make this more obvious. But it was working. So that's quite cool, because if you see this in your code, if you see it like 3+ times, it might be that actually there's a subaddition going on. And if you see this fat error, then it might be that it's an error function expression. Or if you see something that looks like a comment, it might be that there's an invisible Hangul filler in there, and in the end it's a regular expression. So take care and don't copy and paste other codes, but not my code. And now the next step obviously is to combine invisible characters with invisible code. And this is a more complex animation. This is the source code, and if you add some spaces, I have it in script text, it will give you this void. I'm not sure if you see this on the side, but it's like an ASCII art character as the void, and it's animated, and this is like outputting this on source code, which is called a quine, which if you ever heard this term. A quine is a program that outputs itself. It's a funny thing, and I use it quite a lot to kind of. And to explain to you how to write invisible code, you need to look at the ASCII code pages. And in the first ASCII code pages, you might see some characters that are useful to write invisible code, such as the form field, the character term, or you could use like spaces and so on. But the problem with that, or tabs, but the problem with that they're not visible, but they're always taking up space. So the tab is visible in a sense, because it will like push the form code. But on the second ASCII code page, there are a lot of control characters that won't take up any space. And if you can make use of them and somehow encode them, then we would be able to write like invisible code. And to do this, we take our long string with invisible code, we escape this, and then we replace every third and sixth characters, or we take every third and sixth characters, join it together, and you see that with the hex is key. Like backslash hex, to give you an idea. So this is a sequence of control characters. They all start at 001, so they're from the second ASCII page and are not visible. And if we escape them, then we get this dollar sign, one, whatever. And if we then take every third and sixth character and join them together and have this next escape important of them, then we have an escaped string, and this is in the end also visible. So use visible strings to encode any encode. That's the website where we have looked. So the last thing I want to show is something, I would say, not something also called obfuscation in the administrative way. And the only common thing that it has is called polyglot. Polyglot is something that is written in different languages at the same time. create a website called inceptions.com, and when you open this website, you see, see this page. It looks ugly. And once you call it, scroll down, it's even more ugly. But the idea is that this page is a JPEG, a CSS, a JavaScript, and an HTML file at the same time. So it's like a single document, and it's all in one, not separate files, so it has like one entry point, and yeah, it's combining itself in inception, exactly. So, and the basic thing that it does is it opens the index HTML file in a browser as an HTML file. Then the HTML contains a tag with a script tag that has the source hash, and hash means it's the same page, so it will load this on page again. And then this script will write a link, which is a CSS file that also points to the same page. And the link itself has a background URL that's empty, which also means load the same thing as the background. So to explain the code, this is the like the document. It's an HTML, JavaScript, CSS, and JPEG at the same time, and you have different parts. To highlight this, the pink one is JavaScript, the yellow one is the pink one is the CSS, the yellow one is JavaScript, the blue one is the HTML, and the JPEG is the blue one. And to have a look total HTML perspective, we have to serve this as a quantifying text HTML to make the browser ready. It has an HTML. And then we see at one place an inception tag with a feature inside. So this is like a place where we put the render the image. And the HTML also contains a script tag that points to the JavaScript. And the JavaScript then looks like this. And to explain this, in the beginning you have this strange looking variable name, we're going to explain this later, which is assigned. With an object that has an inception property that points to a string, and then we have inception multiplied with an object that has a method background. And this all doesn't make sense, but it has to be there because it's, as you can see, also like valid CSS. To make this work in JavaScript, it would break if you don't add this hoisted function like bar inception function URL, otherwise this would break because it says URL is undefined and inception is undefined. And then we have some comments about things that you're and the most important thing here is then that we write a document right, so we write a link tag that points to a style sheet, and this is the style sheet then, same slide again, and then we have this definition that also doesn't make sense, but we have another place here where the CSS interpreter will break, so this is an invalid expression, so it will stop here, but what we need is every tag inside of the accept the inception tag has the background that's pointing to the URL, and the URL is then the JPEG, which is which contains the data, the image data at the end, and in the beginning it has some information, and if you have this hex code, then you see, okay, the first 4 bytes are identifying this file as a JPEG, and then the next 2 bits say how many bytes are used for the header of the image. It's not the image data. And in the header, then you can add every quote. And that's it. That's the inception. Yeah. Have a look. And one thing at the end, I would say, try this at home, not at work. It's fun. You learn a lot of things on the way, because you have to deep dive into JavaScript. You have to look for other examples. There's a big community around that, and it's super fun to do. And some things to get started is the JSONK website, which has a lot of examples, and everyone is doing a blog post how we did it. So detailed information. Twitter.net is really fast and ongoing, so there are like tons of examples every day showing up. There's a Slack channel, jsgolf.club, where you can ask for help, and people will happen to do these topics. And there's also something going on. It's called the CSS battle.net. It's the same thing for, it's code word for CSS. So you see the result that you have to achieve, and then you have to write a short CSS that you can get to. And of course, from evolution aiming, you have this code core competition here in both, where you can try to have this second edition. And one thing I want to mention, it just started and you have about 2 months left. It's the first international obfuscated JavaScript code contest. So you can submit obfuscated code and it will be it. Voted like the most ugliest or the most beautiful code that does something unexpected. Yeah, and that's it. Thank you.
How many characters did you
need? No, I heard about this yesterday in the announcement when they announced the winners, so it was too late, but I asked when the new competition starts, and I saw it today, and it's about this 7-digit display, but I had to tweak some slides. But I have something from, I would say, 6 years ago that does this 7-segment display in 110 characters.
No more questions? Let's start for Martin.